Hey family, welcome to How Love Works, where we talk about the principles for lasting love. Here we go again. Well, before I get started, I think what I would like to do is I would like to share the biggest reason why I started this channel in the first place. I kind of alluded to it the last time we talked. And I just want to make it very clear that the biggest reason why I started this channel is not to poke fun at black people, obviously, being a black man myself, and certainly not to point any fingers at black women. I think there's enough finger pointing to go around, if you will. But the biggest reason why I started this channel was for information purposes, is specifically for black people in general and for the benefit of our communities. You see, my goal is to educate and empower the black community, and specifically black women, so that it will reflect the common good as well as glorify God. Because in my view, one of the biggest reasons why our relationships are not doing well in the black community is primarily because we have removed God out of the equation altogether. The second reason why I started this channel is to equip women with the knowledge to position themselves for partnership and to try to give them as much information about how relationships work, especially if the goal is for lasting love. It's not possible today in this environment to find the kind of love that you're looking for if you don't have the basic fundamentals of how love works, how men and women relate. Because if you don't have those fundamentals, you're going to continue going down the same rabbit hole and getting the same results. So that's one of the biggest reasons. And I think lastly is, as a Christian man, the Word of God tells me not to conform to this world or anything in it for that matter. And so it's no different when it comes to relationships for me. One of the reasons, again, why a lot of relationships, they go south is primarily because we conform all too often to the norms and the mores of this world. And we don't take into consideration that perhaps we have an assumption that perhaps what these people are telling us, irregardless of what direction it's coming from and who is providing this information, what they're giving us, it doesn't work. I think that if people would just be honest and transparent and evaluate what they're listening to, look at who they're dealing with, I think it would be very clear to you that those people who claim to have some understanding about how love works and how relationships flow, these people are way off the mark. That's just at a minimum. So that's the reason why I started this channel, so that I might be able to wade into much of the current activity and the flow that's going on right now in this environment. So I think right now what I wanted to do is to start going back to what it was that made black people the powerful people that we were, even though we were slaves at one time. I think because of the fact we were able to maintain our faith, our families, that's one of the catalysts that was able to propel us out, because it was the motivation that drove us to get and to release ourselves from the mainstream and the system of dependency that the mainstream developed. Now, sadly, because now that we are out, if you will, from the deficiencies and the dependency of the society, I think we have returned, I think, psychologically as slaves in some sense, because we have totally walked away from our family responsibilities. We've totally walked away from any sense of community that we might have had. And everybody's like a lone wolf. It's almost like, as the Word of God says, that, you know, every man is doing what's right in his own eyes. And we already know, if you've had any understanding or any cursory knowledge of the scriptures, you know that that didn't go well when people kind of go their own way. You know, kind of like what men are doing today, they're kind of going their own way. And if you don't have some understanding of history, you know that's not going to turn out well. So let's go on with what we have been discussing. We have been discussing the seven deadly sins, is what I call it now. The seven deadly sins that cause the relationships of black women to end in epic failure. The seven deadly sins that cause black females' relationships to end in epic failure. We said the first deadly sin, if you will, was mindset. And my hope is, as we go through all seven of these, what you will take away from understanding all seven of these deadly sins, you will take away an understanding that if you allow all seven of these deadly sins to be a part of your activity in and part of the way you express and relate in relationships, you will most certainly have the predictable outcome. That is, you will be alone, or you will have an epic failure. That's the bottom line. That's the reason why I'm going through all seven of these issues, all seven of these deadly sins, because as far as relationships are concerned, they are deadly and they are sinful from the standpoint that you wreak harm and havoc on the living structure we call a relationship. Okay. Now, I said the first deadly sin is mindset. Not a whole lot of time to go into any of this. You have to watch the old videos. Mindset has to do with the philosophical mindset that the majority, not all, but a vast majority of women, they have a mindset that is fixed, that comes from the feminist philosophical perspective. Okay? And if you have a mindset with a feminist philosophical perspective, then what you're looking for in all of your relationships is, you're looking for fairness, okay? You're looking for equal outcome. You are an egalitarian. That's what you are, okay? You are a social justice warrior, if you will. And so if that is your mindset, that works real well on the college campus. That works real well in the corporate office. And if you are going to be, say, a civil rights attorney, or you're going to be an activist, that works real well. But in romantic relationships, doesn't work. Doesn't work. Okay? I've already told you, in nature, there's nothing equal. There's nothing equal. We can't be equal. It's not possible. The only place we're equal is value. We are all equal in terms of value, in terms of equity, if you will. I'm just as valuable to you as you are to me, and vice versa. All of us are equal in value, but that's probably where it ends. All right? That's number one. Number two, the second area is emotional immaturity. Emotional immaturity is self-explanatory. I already said it before. If you're one of these finger pointers, you're one of these people who are constantly looking for excuses, you never examine, you're not a critical thinker, you don't have a disciplined life, you just go from crisis to crisis to crisis, then you, my friend, are more likely an emotional, immature person. That's who you are. And an emotional immature person, that person doesn't even need to consider a relationship with anyone, because you are a, actually you are a deficiency. You're not someone that's going to add value. All right. Deadly sin number three is, I think it was masculine and feminine energy. Again, if you have of the same two energies, masculine and masculine, okay, they kind of cancel each other out. You see that a lot. A lot of black women are, of course, on their jobs, they have to be men, because everybody on the job is a man. Doesn't matter. You have to have masculine energy on the job. All right. You have to initiate. You have to be about it. You have to cultivate. You have to provide. You have to produce. You have to be competitive. That's masculine energy. Okay. But the problem is, that's okay on the job, but that doesn't work in personal relationships. And it won't work long term unless you maintain the polarity. If you are a masculine energy woman who operates predominantly in the masculine energy, then you, my dear, need to find a feminine energy man. You need a receptive man, a man that's more than willing to receive from you. Okay? And you're more than willing to give. You like the area of control. You feel good about controlling. Okay? That's deadly sin number, I think it was three. Deadly sin number four is, we don't understand men. A lot of women think they understand men. They understand what they are attracted to, and what they are attracted to are men who, A, won't commit. They know those kinds of men very well. These are men who won't provide. They know those kinds of men very well. They won't protect them. In other words, I don't mean just physically. They won't protect their feelings. They won't protect their honor. They won't protect them from their own self-interest. In other words, sometimes women test men all the time. And a lot of men, they fail that test because they don't know how to protect a woman from herself many times. Her emotions get the best of her, and he's not mature enough, wise enough, doesn't know or understand women enough to know, okay, I'm not going to allow her to go down this road, because this is not going to be a benefit for this relationship, nor is that going to benefit her, okay? So that's another area. A lot of women just don't understand men, but they understand all these different men who have not been beneficial to their lives. The problem is, the mistake many women make, as well as men do this also. This is not an issue just women do. Because they have been attracted to the same kind of woman or the same kind of man, and they continue to get the same result, instead of going back in their mind and say, why am I constantly attracted to the same kind of woman or the same kind of man? No, they won't do that, because that would be, my dear, my good man, that would be mature. That's what that would be. That would be responsible. Now, I'm attracted to this man because he makes me feel a certain way. I'm attracted to this man because I'm sexually attracted to this man. So I check out upstairs. I'm attracted to this man because he has a lot of bravado. He's physically, he physically does something for me. He gets me going chemically. Once you're making all of your choices based upon those momentary, fast-moving choices, then guess what you're going to get? What you've been getting? Nothing. You're not going to find, and then what's sad about this, a guy like, say me, I'll just use me, I can't use anybody else. A guy like me, you won't give me a, you won't give me the time of day at all. A guy that'll be with you till the day they put you in the box. I'm not going anywhere. And I can do everything these other guys you think will do for you. The difference is what they won't do is they'll never love you. Ever. That's just real talk. And if you want real love, you have to be grown up for that. You can't be a child. If you keep doing what you've been doing, you heard it a million times, and keep doing what you've been doing, you're going to keep getting what you've been getting. If you keep attracting the same kind of guys, you're attracting what you are. You can complain and you can whine about black men. I can say the same thing about black men. You can whine and you can complain about black women all you want. But at the end of the day, your core value system, the way you make your choices, I can look at the people you hang out with. If you hang out with a bunch of single brothers, and all these brothers is about is out here trying to get with these girls, and all they're trying to do is lay them down on their backs and have sex and hit and run. Now, if that's going to be your MO, then what do you expect? You don't have the credibility to make the argument that some black women or most black women suck when all you focus on is these crazy ones. Yeah, 3-5% of black women as well as 3-5% of black men, they gone. Right up here, emotionally, they're gone. There's probably no way you can get these people back because they're so far gone for a lot of reasons. It's not that they just straight crazy. It's not that. There's a lot of reasons why people are just leaving out of here emotionally and psychologically. They're just gone, right? But at the end of the day, what you have to look at is what are you attracting to your life? And as far as your life is concerned, are you expressing life? Are you attracting life? So if I was just attracting a whole bunch of big head females and all I'm doing is knocking them off one at a time, at a time, at a time, and I'm thinking I'm the big man, and I, at the same time I'm criticizing them, I sound like an idiot. And no different with the females. And I'm getting all these comments, females won't be by, they say, I don't even understand that one. I don't even get that. Now, I get it that some women choose to be on their own, and I really don't have an issue with that at all. I'm not trying to be nasty. I get that. But by virtue of just your DNA, the way you were designed, your genetic makeup, God created you for companionship. Now, I recognize the culture is gone. The only people that can be in companionships or long-term partnerships right now are people who are living in alternative lifestyles. Those are the only people that they're elevating. But the majority of us, the 97% of us, we seem to be having a problem. Which we're finding every excuse under the sun. It ain't nothing but the culture. You're buying too much of the culture's nonsense. Don't buy it. Reject it. Don't be conformed to it. It's not going to get you anywhere because it hasn't gotten you anywhere except zero, a big fat zero. You're not getting the love you deserve. And most of it is because of what I always say, because you don't know what you don't know. That's all it is. All right. Now, we're going to be talking about today. Oh, I'm sorry. There's one more. Number 5. I almost forgot about it. Today we're going to be dealing with deadly sin number 5. We're going to be talking about, what is that? That I hate to even bring it up. So bad. Emasculation. I can't spend too much time on this one because if you go online, you see a ton of things on emasculation. I will say this one thing though. When it comes to emasculation, it's just not black women or white women or any woman for that matter. I mean, women, yes, do emasculate males. I've been on the other side of that. I know how it feels. But at the same time, culture emasculates men as well. I know you've heard this a million times, but not only does culture emasculate men, but the toxic environment that we're living in right now, that also is having a tremendous effect on men, especially our testosterone levels as they continue and continue to fall because of many of the foods that we're ingesting and because of all of the chemicals that we are unfortunately being exposed to. They're really having a detrimental effect upon the sex hormone testosterone. And men, we got 100 times as much testosterone as women. But as our testosterone levels go down, you start experiencing a lot of different men who are very difficult to be around. So when you run into a man, this is a clue, ladies. If you run into a man who's having some issues with, I'm not going to go into the sexual side of things, but I'll talk about the anxiety side, the psychological side, and I'll be very brief. When you run into a man who is short in terms of his demeanor, or a man who is short-tempered, or a man who has a lot of high anxiety, 99.9% of the time, that man has very low testosterone. When you run into a man who has issues with pornography, he has low testosterone, okay? All of these things are connected to some, and I'll say to a lot of the problems men are experiencing in the culture when it comes to this issue of emasculation. Men are being emasculated from every direction. That's really my main point. Now, let me give you some of the big reasons why women emasculate men today. One of the reasons is out of fear. We're bigger, we're stronger. Bottom line, we're bigger, we're stronger. Women, they're smaller, and they're not as strong as we are. And so sometimes, as men, we can intimidate women with our size. And so what do? They don't necessarily start striking and swinging on us. They verbally emasculate us. They bring us down a couple of pegs. That's one of the ways they emasculate us. Another way is they punish us sometimes. That's one of the reasons why they do it. They punish us because we may not be doing something that they think we should be doing the way they would do it. Or they think, as I said before, because they don't know men, they think we are nothing more than versions of them and that we understand everything a woman would understand. We feel everything a woman would feel because this goes right back to mindset and the female or feminist ideology that teaches that we are all the same. So if we are all the same, logic concludes that we must think the same way. We must feel the same way. That brings us to the conclusion that if that's the truth, then guess what? When men act out, then they're misbehaving. So women punish us. They punish us through emasculation. And the last one is through frustration. Women get frustrated with us, obviously, for different reasons. And the result is they emasculate us and they lose faith in us. Again, that kind of goes back to if you have a very immature understanding, you have a fixed mindset and you are emotionally immature and you operate in the masculine a little bit too much and you don't understand, man, guess what you're going to do? You're going to emasculate a lot more than the average woman who has some understanding of those categories, those seven deadly sins, even though they've not heard it from me. All right. Now, let me give you the four areas where women, or the four, I call them the four C's. These are the four areas that women use when they emasculate us. One of the big areas is complaining. Men always have something to say about the complaining that their wives or girlfriends or significant others do. Now, I'm not saying these women don't have a reason to complain about probably some very legitimate areas that they see. It's just when they complain or they continuously complain over and over and over and over about whatever the issue may be, They're only affirming the fact that they do not know how to get their needs met. They do not know how to get their significant other vis-a-vis either the boyfriend, the husband, or whatever the guy is in your life. You don't know how to communicate your needs properly, okay? That's what happens when you do a whole lot of complaining. That's a big giveaway. Number two is a lot of women do this. They do a lot of comparing. And As a man, I can't stand that. I can't stand it. Brothers, no brother can stand being compared to another man. Well, so-and-so takes his wife out every Friday. What about, you know, so-and-so washes his wife's car every Saturday. So-and-so keeps the grass cut. And so-and-so does this, and my dad did this, and my family do this. We can't stand that. Because, again, it affirms something else. It's an implication, and it's always negative. And it makes men feel like poop. Makes us feel bad, okay, to say the least. And so when we deal with that area, I guess it drives us down a road that separates us further and further. It just gets us further and further away from our relationships with the women in our lives. And the third one I would say would be competing. Now this, again, this is has to do with being on the job and can't cut it off. And you get home and you're competing with your husband. You're going to outdo him. I remember hearing an article about how Jay-Z and Beyonce, they kind of try to outdo each other when they give gifts to one another. And, you know, that's a competitive thing. Now, it might be all innocent. It's just an example. I don't really care. I really don't. It's just an example that popped in my head that kind of illustrates what people do. The competitive nature of women can really go to the extreme sometimes in relationships. And I think you understand what I mean by that. If you're competing with the man you claim to love, I don't know if you really understand love, okay? And the last one, and I'm gonna be done with this. The last one is, and I think it's the worst one, is criticism. Criticism and contempt, I guess I'll put them together. Criticism and contempt. Contempt is that you just don't care much or have much respect for men in general. If you are a woman that's contemptuous, a contentious woman, if you will, I will tell you this, do everybody a favor, and especially you, don't get in no relationship with no man, period. Because in your mind, men don't matter. Okay? And I will agree with you. I'm not mad at you. Men don't matter. So what's the point of getting into a relationship with them? Stay by yourself. That's cool. Everybody's happy. You're happy. It's a win-win. Okay? Now, criticism is a big one. Criticism is what women use with each other. You see it, as I said, I used this example before. You know, women, if they see another woman wearing their hair a certain way, a woman will criticize her hairstyle. Next thing you know, the woman will change. Now, I realize from a biological standpoint, from the time a woman is born up until the time she goes into postmenopause, most women don't have any defense against criticism. So whatever you criticize in a woman, especially a woman being, and most women are pleasers, they're going to do everything they can to adjust to that criticism. Okay? Now, if you think, like most women think, that men and women are the same, because, as I said, because of feminism, if you have that mindset, you're going to believe that. Then if you believe that, then guess what? You're going to use criticism on men. It's just logical. It just makes sense, right? So if you do that, I'm going to tell you right now how this is going to work. If you criticize a man, and that's one of your or core methods of trying to motivate him, because it motivates you, it doesn't motivate men, because A, we're not women. If a man criticizes another man, it'll be okay to be a joke. If he keeps doing it, we're going to move some furniture. Or as Bernie Mac would say, some brothers are going to be hitting each other till some white meat is shown. Okay? Now, when his wife or his girlfriend or his significant other starts using criticism as a method or a means to try to get that brother motivated, guess what's going to happen? It's going to motivate the brother. It's going to motivate him. But it's going to motivate him away from you. What you are trying to do, even though your intentions are very good, your intentions are good. You're using criticism because it works on you and because you think he's a version of you, and you're going to use criticism and you think it will work. It will motivate him to do something that you know is a good thing. But it's the wrong thing. It's like you can go out and get your car and your car says that it takes premium, and that's the only thing it will take is premium fuel. If you want to, it'll run on regular unleaded, but it ain't gonna run well. No different here. A brother, you can sit here, brothers don't run on criticism. We don't motivate well on criticism. Try criticizing a brother, see how long you stay with him. He ain't gonna stay, even if he does. The quality of your relationship is going to be terrible. Absolutely terrible. So I'm telling you, ladies, all of these things, primarily so that you can have a much better relationship with the man in your life. If you know what you do know now, that criticism, complaining, comparing, contempt, and competitiveness will not work in a relationship. It won't. If you saw your children behaving like that, you would stop it immediately. But it's okay for women to do it in their relationships with men. I'm not talking about some of these knobheads that you get involved with. I'm not talking about these guys. You shouldn't be with them anyway. I'm talking about a man that's decent, that treats you decent. You can't be doing these, you can't be doing those things. Because I'm going to tell you this and I'm done. If I run into any couple, which I've done many times, and if I see any one of those four areas, and that's something I hear over and over again, I already know that relationship's done. I don't have to spend any time with it. If I hear the man or the woman complaining, showing contempt, competing, comparing, right? If I see criticism in a relationship, I already know this thing is done. I don't care if the brother hang, he gonna be sleeping around with other females. The female might do the same thing to him. If that's part of their relationship makeup, that relationship will not stand. It will not stand. No relationship can stand up to that. So I hope you understand, and I hope you learn some things today. I'll see you on the other side. God bless you.